Der nächste Beitrag auf dieser DVD ist ein alter Bekannter, King Diamond, den wir ja kürzlich besucht haben bei sich zu Hause in Dallas. Und wir haben neben dem ellenlangen Interview, das bei uns über drei Hefte lief, haben wir auch ein paar Statements von ihm mit wackeliger Videokamera eingefangen. Wackelig deswegen, weil ich die selber gehalten habe, die Kamera und sowas noch nie gemacht habe. Wichtiger ist aber das, was King Diamond erzählt, nämlich eine lustige Horrorgeschichte in diesem Falle. Ich möchte aber noch erklären, dass dieses ganze Interview und auch das, was ihr jetzt seht, stattfand vor der Herz-Bypass-Operation von King Diamond. Da habt ihr vielleicht im neuen Rockhard drüber gelesen oder im von euch aus gesehen jetzt letzten Rockhard drüber gelesen. Es gab also eine Herz-Bypass-Operation, die sehr aufwendig war und lange gedauert hat, die aber gut gelaufen ist und King Diamond aber so zurückgelassen hat, dass er leider im Moment nicht ans Musikmachen denken kann und auch nicht an die angekündigten Live-Auftritte, die er jetzt in dem folgenden Beitrag selber ankündigt. Es ist leider schon wieder Pause und ja, es ist wie verhext, im wahrsten Sinne des Wortes. Erst ist es der Rücken, der ihn jahrelang außer Gefecht setzt, jetzt ist es das Herz und irgendwie scheint der Mann nicht mehr auf die... auf den Boden zurückzukommen oder zumindest nicht auf europäischen Boden zurückzukommen. Aber wir hoffen natürlich, dass sich das bald ändert und wünschen an dieser Stelle gute Besserung, King. Und das würde ich hoffentlich in Europa bald doch wieder live sehen. Geplant war natürlich ein Auftritt auf dem Rockhard Festival und wie jedes Jahr ist der auch weiterhin geplant. Irgendwann wird er auch stattfinden. Aber jetzt muss sich der gute King erstmal erholen und dann ist es hoffentlich bald wieder soweit, dass wir noch live sehen. Also gute Besserung von hier und viel Spaß mit dem jetzt kommenden Beitrag.
Do you get weird stuff like that happening a lot here?
Not a lot. No, not a lot. We have some things that is definitely from the other side here. There's been some incidents, but not a lot. I mean, the apartment I lived in Denmark, it was haunted like you won't believe. And lots of people saw that stuff, you know. I mean, it was a daily occurrence for me, you know. I got very used to having it around, how things would move around and have been moved and been touched and things like that.
Can you tell one story, for example,
please? No. I mean, there's so many things, you know, that happen up there. So many people experience those things, you know. I mean, if you ever run into Malcolm Dome, who used to be back then, he was the one of the main journalists from Kerrang.
And they hello, Malcolm.
Hi, Malcolm. How are you doing? Remember when you spent the night in the little haunted apartment together with your photographer, Ray Palmer? It was cool, wasn't it? At least it was a nice photo session with the nun, wasn't it? But apart from that, the next morning I remember that, and yeah, I'm sure Malcolm remembers too, but Ray Palmer went out to the bathroom. They had slept on the floor on a mattress actually in my living room. And they were gonna get on a plane a little later. And at that point, Ray Palmer went out to brush his teeth. And then when he came in from there, man, he was white as a sheet. And what he said was, Malcolm, I'm leaving now to the airport. And Malcolm said, what are you talking about, man? We have hours still before we need to leave. I gotta go now, I gotta leave now. And then I said, oh, did something growl at you in my bathroom, is that it? How do you know that? Well, it's happened before, it's not something special, you know, I mean, don't worry about that. No, I can't stay here, I have to go. So they packed their stuff and left early, you know. We had many of those things up there, you know. Photographer that took pictures of me up there. I was with the altar at that time, and I just said to him for fun that when you get back to your dark room, man, there will be not my face, but an old woman's face will be there instead, you know, and you're going to freak out when you see it. There was just nothing on there. Instead, it was just white, and he had to go down to the photo shop and try and figure out what the hell was wrong with his camera. There was nothing wrong, you know. It just wouldn't take pictures of me. But that has happened before too. You know, there was another place, an apartment I lived in here before the house in Dallas. I have a very unique version of the Necronomicon, and it's a numbered hardcover edition where it's hand numbered 666. I have number 666, and it was given to me by a guy that was doing some. He was part of our road crew at a point, and his dad was. He was from Germany actually originally, but he lived in London. And his dad was the. I think he was the German ambassador to London. And he had this book and he wanted to sell it to me, but he was asking a fortune. I was like, I don't have that kind of money for this kind of stuff. And I think a few months after the tour, it just arrived in the mail. He said, it belongs to you, you should have it. So I have that here too. And this guy, a photographer, came up and we tried to take some photos, but the camera wouldn't work. When he pointed it at the book, it would not work. He would do this, no problem. That was, turned it to the book and me, it wouldn't work. It simply didn't work. He left early too. He didn't like the atmosphere, you know, but I mean, I could tell you, I told you a lot of stories yesterday, you know, some of the heavier stuff with people being pulled in the hair and stuff like that. There was only one time where it was really violent like that, but you'll hear some of that in the actual interview that you're going to read, some of those things there with the voice I kind of created and in the studio for House of God, actually. There is this voice in the beginning, this that kind of voice. And when I recorded it, when I heard it back, being played back in the headphones, all the hair was standing. I was like, oh my God, I know that voice. I heard that breathing before in my apartment back in Denmark. And there was something that happened one day where a girl was pulled in her hair and it got a little violent, you know. And I heard exactly that breathing from one corner of my dark apartment there, because I had only one candle lit at that time. We were actually trying to show her something of the stuff that had happened in the apartment. She didn't believe me, and I should not have done that. You normally don't do that stuff, you know, but I really had it with her. She was too obnoxious about, I never saw anything here. And I said, okay, you really want to see something? It took about 5 minutes of very, very intense thoughts, a candle lit, and then a nice little background music from The Exorcist, and suddenly she got pulled by the hair. And I had all my vinyl albums in these plastic covers, and you could hear a hand going over all of them, and then finally it stopped over in the corner, in the dark corner. There was no light over there at all, and you just heard that breathing coming. I think it was 3 or 4 times, and then it disappeared the same way these things always disappeared. It was out my hallway, went down the hallway out to the bathroom and disappeared that way. But of course I could sit here and tell you stories or some of those things that I have experienced for a couple of days if you want, but we don't have the time. Okay. There's some soccer coming on I have to see soon, you know.
Okay, just say bye-bye or something?
Bye-bye. I'll see you on the road, and it's going to be all of a sudden you're going to figure out here very soon that we'll be back in action before you know it.
Thanks a lot.
You're super welcome, all of you.
Thank you.